Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. There are so many other factors which can make a chemical molecule leak recalcitrance. So one of those factors are the environmental conditions where the chemical compound is present. So depending on the conditions of the environment, the chemical compound can be easily degraded or it can be hard to degrade that compound by through biological organisms like microorganisms. So for example, if a leakage of storage tanks tank happens, the chemical compound present in that tank will be spilled on the soil and it will find its way to the groundwaters ultimately, because it is pulled down by gravity, and as it is pulled down, the residual will be left behind on the soil where it was spilled. It will contaminate the surface soil, the unsaturated zone, and finally the aquifer containing the groundwater itself. As you can see in this sketch, for example, this is the leaking tank, and it will find its way ultimately to the groundwater. However, the subsurface areas are not such simple mostly. For example, you can see in this diagram, it is very complex. You can see here again, there is a tank which has been leaked, and the chemical compound present in that tank has found its way through the wetter zone to the groundwater ultimately, and you can see the structure is very complex. So depending on this structure, it can also add to the recalcitrance of the molecule. So after the leakage has been stopped, what we do first is that we clear the soil where the spillage happened, because that soil contains the most concentration of the chemical compound. However, once we have excavated the soil, we have to deal and remove the leftover contamination and pollution as well. So there are so many other things that can be done, and that involves the soil as well as the groundwater. Depend karta hai ki spillage kahan tak pahunchi, kya wo sirf soil tak rahi ya kya it has found its way to the groundwaters as well. So depending on that, different types of approaches can be utilized. So now, as we discuss, subsurface environments are usually more complex, and there can be layering of permeable sands and gravels and impermeable strata as well, which are silts, clays and rock. So both are present over there, permeable and impermeable. So depending on that, the distribution of the compound will vary, and depending on the distribution of the compound, its accessibility to the microorganisms will hinder as well. Now the mixture of gravel, sand, silt, clay and organic matter can vary widely. Depending from one side to another, the composition of the soil can be different. So depending on the composition of soil, one compound may be less toxic in one site at one site, but it will be more toxic at other site, partially due to the fact that it is easily degraded at one site but not so easily degraded at the other site, and the factors are obviously the same: the presence and the activity of the microorganisms, and whether the compound is accessible to the microorganisms or not. Now, the recalcitrance may also result from the contaminant remaining in the non-aqueous space. Jaise humne pehle bhi zikr kiya tha ki agar contaminant aqueous space mein nahi hai, water ke saath mix nahi ho raha, to again it will be hard to be degraded by the microorganisms. Or it has penetrated into fissures or small pores and minerals. Microsites mein wo hai present, aur microsites mein, un microsites mein bacteria ya other microorganisms present nahi hai. So again, inaccessible hai to the microorganisms. Or the compound has strongly soaked to the particle surfaces. Uski affinity kitni hai wahan pe maujood particles ke saath, minerals ke saath. Agar wo bahut zyada affinity rakhta hai wahan pe present minerals ke saath, to uski mobility bahut kam ho jayegi. To it is soaked on the materials, minerals strongly over there. So again, it will be unavailable to the microorganisms, and therefore it will not be degraded. All of these factors can render the contaminants unavailable to the microorganisms, and therefore unki biodegradation nahi hogi, and that makes them recalcitrant. If you talk about the presence of microorganisms, obviously they need certain electron donors and carbon sources to grow. They have their own requirements, so the availability of those things can also affect the biodegradation. Now, recalcitrance may also result from insufficient nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus. So these are basically can be limiting factors for the growth of microorganisms and bacteria. So you can see here, microorganisms and bacteria, they do have their own certain requirement, and those should be fulfilled at least minimally. So if the nutrients, the essential nutrients are not there, the bacteria and the microorganisms will not grow, and therefore the compound, the chemical toxic compound, will not be degraded. And when these nutrients are below optimum levels, the amount of biomass obviously will be low because the nutrients are low, and the biodegradation may take place, but the rate of biodegradation will be very slow. Now, if the environmental conditions are suitable, all the nutrient requirements are met, all the physiological requirements are met, and the compound is accessible to the microorganisms present over there, provided the microorganisms do have the metabolic pathways to degrade the compound, the biodegradation will take place and it may lead to complete mineralization of that compound. On the other hand, if the environmental conditions are not met, or any of the factors which are required for the proper growth of microorganisms, and for the accessibility of the microorganisms to the compound, if those are not met, then the biodegradation may not take place at all, or it may take place but at slow rate, and reduced efficiencies will be there. So this was about the effect of environmental conditions that can make a compound recalcitrant. I will see you in next lessons.